Each year, Microsoft Research hosts hundreds of influential speakers from around the world, including leading scientists, renowned experts in technology, book authors, and leading academics, and makes videos of these lectures freely available.
Hello? Hello! Welcome! Welcome to Design Expo 2015. In case you're wondering about the slideshow that was going as you guys were arriving, this was an inclusive visual identity that we came up with. It was a joint effort here at Microsoft and outside. We created the main symbol that you can see in color, and we asked other people to reinterpret that symbol, which is a capital letter D, in a way that it represents inclusive design. So that's what you were looking at. And this event is public, open to the public, so feel free to tweet. And if you tweet, use the hashtag DExpo15, which is our hashtag for this event. I was the first one to use it, so please fill it up. So starting with just a bit of feedback about background about this. There's been so much feedback, I'm a little kind of getting out of that mode. Background about Design Expo. It's about identifying some key challenges that the world is facing and giving them out to top design schools around the world and seeing how they interpret the problem. And another goal is to enhance long-term relationships across the schools and between Microsoft and the schools. We had a couple success stories from the past when a couple schools met in here, Design Expo, a Brazilian school and a school from the Netherlands, and they started an exchange program. We also had one of our Design Expo alums go found a company, which happened to be Foursquare. So he passed through this room just like you guys. So we like to foster this community with Microsoft and also across the schools. And this is the 12th year we're doing Design Expo. So we've been doing this for a while. So the process, we start at the end of the year, we start by selecting the topic, and then we select a set of schools, and it's usually 8 schools worldwide, and we rotate through the schools. And then we assign Microsoft liaisons, which are people who travel to the schools to meet with them and give them feedback throughout the process. And each school starts a semester-long course on the project, and then the liaison goes back to the school to select the final project that is here. So you guys, if you're here, it's because you're a winner. So be happy for yourselves, and you made it. And we're super happy to see what you have. And today's the day they present, and they present for 8 minutes and then get feedback from the amazing critics here. The design challenge this year is inclusive design. And in 2014, the World Health Organization has radically revised their definition of disability. They're defining it as a context-dependent condition versus an attribute of the person. So in this way of looking at disability makes us realize that we all go through disabilities throughout our days and throughout our lives. From being in the sun and not being able to see my screen to being somewhere that's really noisy and not being able to hear. Or when I'm driving, I am cognitively disabled and visually impaired when I'm doing that task. So we asked the students to look at a spectrum from permanent disability to temporary to situational. An example of permanent would be somebody who amputated their arm to a temporary case, which is a new parent who has to do everything one-handed because they're holding a baby on the other hand, to... I blanked that. To situational when you have like a broken arm, for instance. Or when you're carrying groceries outside the store. So this, just to say that it happens throughout our days and throughout our lives. And we think that by designing for the 1%, we end up benefiting everybody. So we just think it's a good design process. These are our participating schools. We have Pontifical Catholic University from Rio, Brazil, University of Applied Sciences, Potsdam, Germany, Carnegie Mellon University from the US, Korea Advanced Institute of Science and Technology, KAIST from Korea. Both KAIST and PUC Rio are it's their first year during Design Expo. We have Delft University of Technology from the Netherlands. NYU Shanghai program. Art Center College of Design. And our neighbors, University of Washington. We have amazing critics sitting right here in front of you, and I will go ahead and introduce them. I hope you like the pictures I picked for you guys. It was on the web, so I felt. So Rob Gerling is a co-founder of local design and innovation firm Artifact. His career started at Apple in 1991 and 1992 when he won the Apple Student Interface Design Competition for concepts around mobile and personal computing. Rob then joined Microsoft for 10 years. He started at the office team. He then worked in games and eventually became the design manager responsible for the user experience and branding for Windows XP. He worked briefly on Vista before going to join IDEO as senior interaction designer. And at IDEO is when he decided he should go found Artifact. And he founded Artifact, which has been around for almost 10 years now. And prior to founding Artifact, Rob worked at Sony Computer Entertainment of America. Thank you, Rob. We're very happy to have you. Our next critic is Angelo Satira, who has met the grumpy cat in person, so we can get his autograph later. Angelo is an American entrepreneur and co-founder of the online community DeviantArt that most of you probably know about. And DeviantArt is a social network for artists and art enthusiasts and a platform for emerging and established artists to publish, promote, and share their work with an enthusiastic artistic community. DeviantArt has over 32 million registered users, and it attracts over 65 million unique visitors per month. The community members upload over 160,000 pieces of artwork every day. Angelo co-founded DeviantArt at 19 years old, and it was not his first company. He founded another company 4 years earlier, when he was still a baby, a music file sharing site called Dimension Music, and he sold it in 1999 before starting DeviantArt. Thank you, Angela, for being here. Oh, I forgot to say he was born in Greece and he's an Aquarian like myself. Next, we have Wendy March, senior designer for Intel's new devices group. Oh, you're not new for the new devices group? Is that not you? Okay, that's what was on your website. What's your role? User experience manager for Intel's new devices group. Her current work focuses on speech interfaces, a new form of interactions with physical devices. She has also led projects that explore new forms of interaction with mobile devices that are enabled by sensors, which happened to be the topic of last year's Design Expo. And advanced imaging technologies, especially new types of gaming. She also led projects that included reimagining domestic robots, the future of smart streets, and how the design of digital money can reflect our social values. Wendy has an MA in computer-related design from the Royal College of Art in London, which has participated in Design Expo, the school, and a Master of Science in Information Systems from the University of Brighton. Prior to working at Intel, Wendy also worked at IDEO and also interned at Apple in her early career. Thank you, Wendy, for being here. I wanted to give special thanks to our veteran, Mike Caspero. Mike is just over here. He's our honorary critic. He has been helping students present better and giving them creative feedback for the last 9 years of Design Expo. And Mike is now a senior vice president and executive creative director at Proximity in Toronto, Canada. And I learned that Toronto, Canada was voted the best city for 5 years in a row. And Mike has a spare bedroom. And thank you to the liaisons, and thank you to Unati Dani for coming up with the visual identity and the whole visual identity team. Thank you. We're ready to start with our first team, Rio de Janeiro Pontifical Catholic University with Mesh, reliving memories, emotions, and impressions.
Hello. First of all, it's a huge pleasure to be here today. We are from Bukihio, the Catholic University of Rio de Janeiro in Brazil. And my name is Patricia. And these are my team colleagues, Iris, Jessica, and Rafael. We are here today to present our project, which is focused on the visually impaired. So there are about 285 million people visually impaired worldwide. And according to the World Health Organization, there are four levels of visual acuity that goes from normal vision to blindness. We decided first to focus on the three last levels to interview. So our first conclusions were that, first you ask, who are they? What do they like to do? Which challenge do they face? And our first conclusions were, there are some subjects that came up, like they talk about their feelings, about where do they like to travel to, how they interact with people. And there was this particular subject that was memory. We talked with Aline. This is Aline. She's a girl severely with severe visual impairment. And she has the habit of keeping a journal. Actually, she blogs. So she likes to share her experiences and feelings online and share with people. And then we started talking about memory also with the other interviewers. And they talk about storytelling and relating memories to events and places. So realize the strong connection between people and the recalling of past experiences.
Among these statements, we found three quotes that were interesting for us to work with. So, like, most of the tools designed to keep memory rely on vision. My memory is like a photo album to me. The Eiffel Tower means nothing to me. The most important is what I've done there. So, those three phrases showed us that memories are related to places and events. And as for fully sighted people, they rely on visual aspects such as photography and video. And how about the visually impaired? They don't rely to visual aspects, but they still have the connections between places, events, and their moments. That's the point. There is so much more to memory than only visual aspects. So,
So what about you guys? What do you do to remember? What is memory to you? We have a lot of ways of keeping memory on a daily basis. For instance, when you check in your favorite restaurant, or when you go out with someone special and you tag it and on social media. The bottom line is, remembering is our way of treasuring our past. And that's why we created Mesh, the memory sharing. Mesh is a system that allows users to capture, relive, and share memories through a wearable device using an online platform. With Mesh, you can capture and relive sensations, and you can share and discover memories to and from others.
But how do you capture a memory? Well, every interaction done with Mesh service is done by this little device here. And for you to capture a memory, you just need to tap in the bottom of the device. And for doing that, all the auditive information will be recorded by my microphone here. The temperature of your skin will be recorded in the back of your ear. And there will be a sensor near the user's temples that will record the heartbeat. All the representation of this memory will also be done by this device in the same three parts. And for reliving the memory, you just need to search it using those three characteristics. The name of the user that recorded this memory, the place that it was recorded, and the date it was recorded. By instance, I'll show just like you just have to tap here and say, relive my memory on April 15, 2012, on Rio de Janeiro. And if you're not looking for any specific memory and you want to search for something interesting, you just have to tap it here again and say, relive memories randomly, and then walk around looking for memories that will astonish you. But every memory, by default, is only personal and private. And you need to share it for make it public for other people. And you can do that by two things. You can share directly to someone's Mesh, or you can use social network, such as Facebook on Twitter. You just need, when you record a memory, or just relive then, you tap and say, share on my Facebook, and then tag your friends, such as tag Maria Bonelli.
So you might be wondering for whom Mesh was designed for. By all means, for everyone with different levels of visual acuity.
My love, I miss you a lot. I wish you could be here with me.
Ich reise der ganzen Welt mit meinem Freund für 2 Monate. Viele fantastische Dinge sagen wir, aber ich bin einfach nicht wie nach Hause zurückkommen.
Quatsche. Chciałam powiedzieć, że tutaj jest bardzo zimno.
Cześć.
Wow. This is the best thing I've done in my life.
Thank you.
Thank you. Now, off to the judges' comments. want to start, Rob?
What a commendable job, guys. I actually saw, I'm cheating a little, because I saw the presentation on Monday, and we had some concerns with the way it was presented, and you guys have totally addressed all of that, and then some, and totally nailed the timing, and you've done a great job. So congratulations on that component of this, which is an important component, right? The storytelling of your method and process. I'm really struck by the power of the video to convey the idea. I think the simple voice user interaction for a call based on place and voice key phrases is probably a pretty good start at the UI. There's going to be some challenges there with on that April 12th day in 2012. There was quite a lot of activity and it trying to sort of disseminate between different types of activities could be quite challenging, but I think that's it's a commendably simple user experience, at least in at this level. And I think the form factor as well deserves some nice. It's very discreet. It actually looks quite fashionable. There's a kind of nice wearable kind of aesthetic to it. And so I just want to congratulate you guys on a job well done in communicating the power of your idea. In a quite challenging space, so well done.
I really agree with that feedback. I really like the result. Like, I love the way that you ultimately post this to Facebook, and you have a visualization of the experience and that little kind of heartbeat piece. And I think the more that you guys expand on that piece and that resulting product, the more you'll drive people to want to engage in that behavior. So that's really, really emotional and really, really like human and really great. So I think that'll transcend nicely on in social spaces. I'm not so sure about kind of the hardware components or the wearable components. I think that you've done a phenomenal job with it so far, and I look forward to seeing you guys progress on the hardware piece. So yeah, terrific.
Thank you. Well done. I have worked on something that goes around your ear. It's really hard. Getting things to fit people's ears. So I think that was nice. I mean, very kind of simple, and you thought about that. I thought it was a very interesting space to think about. You know, as you say, most memory-related things tend to be visual. Although people have, for centuries written novels and journals. But it's an incredibly important thing for people. So I think that was a very interesting space to focus on. I'd have liked to have seen a little more prototyping happening, I think, to understand both what you're capturing and then the prototyping of kind of playing it back and kind of having some sort of showing that, this is how people felt about it and this is how it worked and this is what a memory was made of. I think that would have been really, an important part. So I think for another project that, kind of bringing that out would be really important. Okay. But very nice, thank you. We're all terrified of being over time. That's right.
Okay, we have 3 minutes for questions, but you guys should switch. Well, I mean, the next team should start coming, and then we'll open for questions. Yeah, Phil? I'll repeat the question.
I'm just curious if you thought about your examples of recording someone speaking, but I'm interested in audio and sound, and I think that ambient sound is actually very evocative from every point of view, without the recording. So, did you look into that at all?
Yeah. So the question is, I just need to repeat the question for folks in the video, that you guys talked about recording sound, but ambient sound is another great thing to be recorded. Have you included
actually,
that?
Actually, yes, we haven't. We decided to cut this from the presentation because of terms of time, but we have two devices, and each one of them will have one microphone. So we used kind of binaural sound capturing for an environmental sound recording. It was in the process of the project, but we decided to cut off because we're not the focus of the user experience.
Thank you. Any more questions from the audience? Okay. Yeah, in the back, two in the back. What's the length of the recording? What's the length, the duration?
Hi, we didn't really decide for a length, but it should have because you could, yeah, but you can record forever because you can forget that the device is on and it's gonna be recording everything. So yeah, we have to decide on length, and that's a good idea. Thank you.
Do you have time for more? Thank you. Now we have team Tracktile, explore a city with your hands and ears, from University of Applied Sciences, Potsdam in Germany. And they have physical prototypes to share with you guys.
Hello, 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 hello. Can you hear me? Yeah? Nice. Okay, hello everyone. We're Patrick, Cecile and Johannes from the University of Applied Sciences in Potsdam, Germany, and we're proud to present our project Tracktile. So, we started with a simple question. How do blind and visually impaired people explore a city? So we humans, we're very visual creatures, and when we think about how a blind or visually impaired person would explore a city, we think that there's a lot they can't experience and a lot that they're missing because, well, they just can't use their eyes. But we didn't actually want to define visual impairment as a deficit, as something that removes those affected from an essential part of human experience. Instead, what we wanted to do was try and see if there was something to be gained for everyone from the way they experienced the world. So how can we explore a city without our eyes? First, there are your immediate physical surroundings, just the space around you. So what's the floor like? Are you walking on grass or is there pavement maybe? Is it raining? Are you perhaps cold or uncomfortable? Then you start to listen and maybe you can hear strangers talking. Maybe there's a park across the street and you can hear the birds in the trees. Or maybe there's a street just up the block and you can hear the cars rushing past. Then there's your sense of orientation and the knowledge you have of your surroundings. So do you know where you're going? Do you know the name of the street? Do you know that there's a great coffee shop just to your right? So all these different states of feeling, of knowing, of hearing, of remembering, these make up our experience of the cityscape. But there are other people in the city as well, and all of them, they have their own experiences, their own stories, and their own memories. And we wanted to make it possible to share those with friends or with just anyone, really. We wanted to give you the means to explore or discover an entire city in a new way, to connect with it, to learn about it, perhaps even to fall in love with it. Tracktile is an electronically and digitally augmented tactile map that makes it possible to explore a city with your hands and with your ears. And Patrick will now talk about the magic behind Tracktile.
But Tracktile is not only an object, but there's a whole service around it. First thing you do is you go to the website and select the destination and the sites you want to see. For example, Berlin and Checkpoint Charlie. Then you order your customized map. When it arrives, you can really get in touch with the cityscape by feeling out streets, buildings, parks, and water through the different surface structures we used. But what makes Tracktile really different to other tactile maps? With Tracktile, you can use your ears to discover even more. There are three different audio layers on the map, which can be activated separately. The first one, which is on every map, includes the basic information about a city, like street names, important buildings, and points of interest. The second layer is a community layer where you can access different content shared and created by other tactile users, like helpful informations and reviews, but also sound recordings of the noises of a city to really feel the atmosphere. But you can also create this content yourself during your trip. And this content is included in the third layer, your personal one. You can sync and store these audio recordings onto your map, which makes it easier to live your memories, to relive your memories. And you can also share them with the community, if you like. So let's have a closer look to Tracktile in real life. Now you will hear the basic layer, which helps you to prepare your trip and understand a city layout.
Unter den Linden. Pariser Platz, Brandenburger Tor.
The community layer gives you the possibility to learn more from the blind and visually impaired community.
Beer Garden Schleusenkrug, great beer garden in a beautiful park near the river. Checkpoint Charlie, it was quite an experience standing on the border of the Berlin Wall.
You can use our fully accessible app for sound recordings during your trip. And you would be surprised how well visually impaired people can use smartphones. After your trip, you can sync and store your recordings to your map and use it to relive and share your memories. Now to Cecile.
Now, you've just seen our second prototype in action, but how did we get there? To evaluate if our concept could be realized, we started prototyping in an early stage. This is a work in progress picture of our first prototype. It is made of paper, and as you can see, it's already electronically augmented and functional. And this is the finished prototype. It shows a map of downtown Berlin. We did a lot of testing with different papers and their structures in order to explore how to represent streets and how to distinguish buildings from them. We experimented with Braille, but we decided against it in the end because we don't want to exclude those who cannot read it. We also have all our prototypes with us, and we'd love it if you try them out later in our booth in the open showcase. So we engaged with the community and got in touch with a lot of online users on Facebook groups, and they gave us insights about orientation and navigation in the city and traveling with visual impairments. During our first research phase, we met Michael, who is very active in the blind community and who likes to travel to new places. He tested our first prototype and later also the others, and gave us valuable feedback about distances and sizes on the map layout and ways to improve them. He also said that this map would help him to prepare his next journey, and that he would understand the city, street layout, and give him more autonomy in addition to his cane. Also, we met with the mobility group of the Blind and Visually Impaired Association in Berlin, and they gave us qualified feedback about our formal style and really important facts about tactile patterns and marks. If you want to learn more about our research, we have a really detailed documentation of our website, which is tractile.co. So our research led us to our development of the second prototype. And here we focused more on formal and aesthetic properties like surface structure and the overall look and feel. We CNC milled MDF and used different patterns for the different kinds of parks, green spaces, and waters. And we varied the sizes and widths of streets. During our research, we felt that there was a real demand for a portable version. And so we developed one. We developed a third prototype, which is foldable and fits into your pocket. So you can explore a city while you are on the go. Well, you can try it out later in our booth.
It was just working.
It's too nervous, apparently.
We just tried it back there and it worked.
Yeah. The best thing is to try it out yourself.
Can't be true.
It's a nervous map.
Thank you.
Well. Just a
Everybody
second.
Clapped.
So, it was our goal to create more than a tool. It was our goal to create more than a tool, a beautiful and aesthetic, perhaps even poetic object. Something that has a quality for everyone, whether they're blind, visually impaired, sighted. And we believe that Tracktile is a beautiful way to explore a city with your hands and with your ears. Thank you.
Thank you, Potsdam. Come see them at the booth today from 6 to 8 so you can use it. We've seen it work. Now off to the judges' comments. Who would like to start?
So thank you very much. That was very nice, despite that moment that we've all had. So absolutely, kind of, you know, always happens. So I thought, you know, one of the interesting things about that presentation was that there was sort of like, oh, you know, what about your research? And then you came in with the research and kind of questions about, well, it's a little bit clunky, you know, but then you moved on to it being, you know, sort of foldable and, you know, much like a general city map. And I thought that the way that you'd thought through that process, you obviously don't have much time to present, but it kind of showed a really, you know, I really like to see that you'd really thought through lots of the issues and explored them and prototyped it and really kind of pushed that. So I think that was great. Of course, still have lots of questions about it. And, you know, and but you have a website, so maybe I should go off and read it. But kind of knowing that there...
You can meet us later in the booth.
Or see it in the booth later. So, I mean, I thought it was a really nice project. You know, the kind of, that you'd also come out both with a very sort of functional, but also as aesthetic thing, which was really nice to see that you kind of pushed both angles of that and pushed something that you really tried to make usable by the community that you were designing for. So that's great.
Okay, so I love this. I mean, I love this more than I can put to words because it's exactly what you might imagine that I might love, because especially the community layer. Which so I think any time that you can take something physical or something that's hardware that can become the center point of the connection for your community, you have an incredibly powerful platform. I'm sure I'm probably going to pitch you your own idea here, but But you know, I think when the cumulative effect, if you can get this into the hands of the people that need it, and the community connection point. So first you start off navigating your city, but ultimately the community layer allows those members to begin to connect. And that connection point brings like people together. And I can tell you beyond a shadow of a doubt that when that occurs in society, it makes the world a better place for the people that are benefiting from it. So, you know, I commend you on this thing. This is really, really exciting. I'd love to talk to you later about it. But I don't know, raving reviews, great feedback. I don't know the exact technological things with it. This is not my field, so you guys know a lot more than me. But you know, assuming that you can get this to a good price point and into the hands of the demographic, it's very, very, very exciting, and I love the intention behind the project. This is just great.
Likewise, I'm very, very have a lot of desire for one of these on my wall, connecting me to a place, you know, that I love, and I'm sure many people in the audience would be able to identify with that idea of being sort of somehow connected through some object, a large scale wall installation or something. And I actually quite like the way you both are helping a clearly disabled user and going after that use case, which is very difficult. And at the same time, designing, like choosing not to include Braille is a quite bold choice in this project, particularly to make it more inclusive of everybody, right? So this is something that both visually impaired and non-visually impaired can both enjoy. I think there is a question still around the sort of, is this for preparation before, you know, learning the city, or is it for experiencing the city while I'm, you know, while you've got the mobile version, or is it for reflecting on the city? And perhaps in conclusion there, it's all three, and it's equally good at all aspects of that, and which is even more commendable, because you would have thought it would be specifically sort of dialed into one of these, and I think you've done a good job making it address each of those kinds of scenarios. So congratulations. Great presentation too, visually.
We don't have time for questions.
Okay. Questions later in the booth.
Questions later at the booth. Thank you, guys. Next up, we have Carnegie Mellon University with Gatherwell, Creating Shared Knowledge.
Hi, I'm Jane, and this is Lorraine and David. We're from Carnegie Mellon University, and we're here to share a concept called Gatherwell. I'd like to introduce you to Laura. So Laura was admitted to the hospital for pneumonia just a few days ago. Unfortunately, her experience there was overwhelming. She mainly worked with Dr. Lee, but she also came in contact with a number of other medical professionals. Her husband, Nathan, tries to visit as often as he can, but he also has to take care of their baby at their home. On top of managing communications with her doctors and her family, she also has a ton of information given to her, from, you know, test results to home care instructions. So Laura is, you know, having to deal with all this, and it's really overwhelming already. But imagine if, sorry. Oh, yeah, so, yeah, she's not alone. It's really not uncommon to have this experience. And in our early research stages, we came across one patient who we talked with, and she had 18 different medical care providers in just one hospital stay. Another patient told us about how she had a surgeon and a physical therapist give her conflicting information, and she left just not knowing what to do. And this is not an uncommon experience. And in the midst of all this, you can imagine how much more difficult it might be if Laura was deaf. And she's not alone in this. In one study, 41% of deaf patients left their health appointment feeling confused about their medical appointment. And this is a really critical moment when they leave, because if they're not understanding their treatment, their illness, then it can really lead to readmissions unnecessarily. And hospitals want to prevent readmissions because of exponential costs. So we wanted to learn more about healthcare, and the field of communication. In order to do so, we first interviewed 26 individuals, from patients to nurses and social workers, academic researchers, as well as designers in the field of healthcare. We also conducted workshops, such as role-playing and card sorting. We observed nurses and social workers in the hospitals. And we also did usability tests through experience prototyping and rapid concept testing in two senior living communities and a medical center's innovation center. So this is a photo from one of the experience prototyping sessions where we had a participant pretend to be a deaf patient interacting with a doctor, and we had real-time transcription happening. And here's a clip from that session.
Do you have any questions about what an ACE inhibitor is?
It's really great to see it on the wall. My family doctor was telling me I might have to go on ACE inhibitors, but that's all he said. He never explained it.
Okay.
So if you could explain it a little further, that'd be great.
So
what this experience prototyping really taught us, as well as some of the other research, is that a lot of the interactions we want are possible today. But what we want to do is think about how we can push this idea further and think about the future. So we decided to design an ecosystem of multiple technologies that can really create the seamless experience. And now Lorraine will talk more about our key interactions and insights.
After spending much time going through our research, meeting and interviewing with these people, we consolidated our research into three key insights. So one of them is that discharge information is often very cryptic and lengthy because it is a process that involves many procedures and conversations. And discharge papers that aim to consolidate all of this into a single piece of paper or several pages of paper may not ensure that the patients are ready to leave the hospital. So in response to that, GatherWell summarizes and captures each conversation that happens with tagging and visualization so that instead of having to sift through pages of paper, you can easily extract key information very quickly. And secondly, we learned that medical interaction is a group experience that involves many, many stakeholders, and they have to be on the same page. So in response to that, GatherWell also offers remote virtual conversation where stakeholders can join medical conversations anytime, regardless of location. And lastly, we learned that hearing disabilities create major communication barriers, communicating medical information, delivering them and receiving them. When we were talking to a deaf interviewee, she revealed us that deaf patients oftentimes at hospital, they're very, very reliant on in-hospital translators with very limited independence. So in response to that, GatherWell offers real-time live translation and transcription of American Sign Language so that they can be independent and depend less on human assistance. And also, the service offers both translation and transcription in ASL and text, American Sign Language, because it revealed us, through research, we learned that deaf community, the members of it, sometimes may prefer one or the other as ASL is considered a separate language from English. So here is a video that demonstrates the concept.
Thank you.
Excited about what this combination of technologies can provide. It's not just a simple translation service, but a combination of multiple technologies. So for a conversation between a patient and the doctor, we're using augmented reality glasses to give that live translation. For caregivers, in this case, the husband, can also join the conversation through remote access. And then also, all of the stakeholders can be involved through the transcription and the summary capabilities so that they can review those conversations at a later time. And we're also, it's also interesting because this technology can also span across a spectrum of other types of people, not just those in the deaf community. For example, somebody who is temporarily disabled, like say somebody is waking up from anesthesia, they could use this, especially the transcription abilities, to review the conversations that happen. Also, somebody that may be situationally disabled, like somebody in a foreign country, could use this for the live translation capabilities, as well as the remote access, because they could invite their doctor at home to join the conversation. And then beyond that, just really any patient can use this this technology to kind of bring everyone to the table and be on the same page on the patient's journey to wellness. Thank you.
Thank you, CMU. Who would like to start?
Well, great job, guys. Also saw this on Monday, so it's come a long way, and you've done a great job answering some of the questions and clarifying some of the points that you've obviously done a great deal of work on. I'm a big fan of the, you know, sort of the transcribing, collecting, and representing back to patients, you know, what is the course, recommended course of action, the next steps, how to get to your next appointment, follow-ups, all of the kind of cryptic stuff that, and even a service that did that part alone would be, you know, a huge step forward for a lot of people, because I'm sure we're all disabled to some degree cognitively by post-illness, just trying to sort of remember what the course of actions are. I feel like this may be a project that sort of suffers from like one too many ideas a little bit, and the augmented reality translation layer where the caregiver is essentially, there's a superimposition on her doing an animation of the actual sign language. So she prefers the sign language than just the text in this scenario. I feel like whilst that probably will happen at some point in the future, it's probably a fairly distant moment, and I'm not sure the sort of lift is worth the benefit right now. And there's sort of some issues there around what if she was gesturing in something important gesturally, and how would the sign language interpret that that was not, you know, something that it didn't need to sort of take over or sort of crush, if you know what I mean. Mm-hmm. So I had some questions around that aspect of it, but overall, I think it's a very, very commendable effort and would have a wide variety of potential beneficiaries. Congratulations.
I wish I could be a little bit more helpful. I mean, I think you know, from the aesthetic here, it's, you know, this is obviously very useful technology. You know, I love the clean design. I mean, it feels like a special purpose sort of Skype in design, and so that's really, really attractive and seemingly very functional. I mean, I think to your points, you know, there is probably quite a bit of complexity in there. You wouldn't really know exactly how well this works unless you were kind of in the dynamic, and so I'm kind of lacking that perspective. But you know, elegant from your presentation. So congrats, seems like a lot of hard work.
Yeah, very nice. I agree, I think, with Rob. I mean, I think it's really nice, but maybe a bit overly complicated, and maybe taking like one part of that would have been, you know, easier to both express that idea in a short time, but also kind of easier to engage us, your audience, I think, in kind of really, like, what was going on in that AR video? I was like completely confused. I think also, but you do have this like really great idea here about, you know, the importance. Nobody understands, no one can remember anything the doctor said as soon as they go outside the door. It's a well-known phenomenon that it's completely like, no matter how much, you know, that's why they say take a friend and take notes, and you both sat there completely befuddled and then leave and have no idea what they said. So, you know, this, that importance of conveying that information, there's a, you know, the being both deaf or not actually being in a foreign country, being in your own country and speaking another language is can be a huge barrier, because you have to wait around in pain till someone comes who can explain in a language you can understand what's going on is terribly traumatic for people. So, you know, so I think that would be brilliant. So I think really focusing on what's core there is that really actually, you know, how do you explain stuff to people and so that they can remember it? I think that's really powerful and well worth exploring more.
We have time for one question from the audience. No questions? Okay, so thank you so much, CMU. Next up, we have KAIST, Korea Advanced Institute of Science and Technology. From Korea, it's their first time participating in Design Expo. Their project is called Sparkle. It's a visual feature description system.
Hey. We're Team Sparkle from KAIST Korea. I'm Cho Ro-jun, and these are my team members, Jong-hyuk, Sung-bae, and Sung-won. Let's start with how our idea emerged and led us here. 285 million people in this world, which is approximately 1 in 25 people, are with visual impairments. Most of them have visions. Some of them have no visions at all, but most of them have a sense of color. We conducted a contextual inquiry with people with visual impairment. We followed them shopping and we volunteered to help them shopping. And we found out this. I would like a pink boxy cardigan. They say it's trendy. They say it's a woman with visual impairment. Trendiness and fashion matter to sighted people. And not surprisingly, they also matter to people with visual impairment. But how do they wear and choose clothes without visions? So this is the very question that led us here to Redmond. How do people with visual impairment see clothes? With this question in mind, we conducted more interviews with people with visual impairment. And we found out there are two kinds of information during the shopping. First, non-visual information like thickness, material, texture can be gathered directly by the people with visual impairments through touch. Second, visual information, however, can only be gathered indirectly through the help of another person. Assistants like clerks, friends, family need to verbally communicate and describe the colors and patterns to people with visual impairment. And we noticed that there is a great deal of inconvenience during this process, especially around the describing colors and patterns. Imagine you're describing this call to your friend. How would you describe the patterns to your friend? What about colors? Please take a look at these two colors. How would you describe the difference between two colors? I can say the two are blues, and one is darker, and one is lighter. But that's not the only things that we see. You know that the two are similar, but definitely different. And it is hard for us to verbally describe the difference. And this is what happens during the process. Assistants, even if they're eager to help, they struggle to verbally describe the difference. And we wanted to sparkle up the situation. We decided to help and improve the verbal description process. For that, we're going to use crux power, and technologies. There are two people involved in the shopping process. Assistants are going to use the Sparkle app to better describe what they see. And people with visual impairment will use the Sparkle band to better recognize patterns in the clothes. And this together is called Sparkle. And here is our video. And after the video, the brother will continue the presentation. Thank you. She lost her vision just a few years ago. Despite her disability, she still actively enjoys cultural lives. Here, she suddenly feels like she should go out and buy some new clothes. Jongyo is a good brother, but certainly not a fashion star. Youngju tells her brother to take her shopping. Her brother resists it at first, saying he wants to enjoy the weekend. But as his sister insists, he says yes. He is a good brother. The two arrives at the department store. Youngju is trying to buy some cool clothes for spring and summer. It seems like she has a pick. She wonders how does its patterns look like. Oh, the patterns are too complicated for her brother to explain. She does not just stand there and watch. She uses her Sparkle. The Sparkle band delivers information about clothes by analyzing the clothes image and displaying it on the braille display. Jongyo uses the Sparkle app. The Sparkle band sends the visual data to the Sparkle app. The Sparkle app displays the suitable description words of the visual data on the screen. Jonghyuk describes how clothes looks and feels to Youngju in more detail with the help from the Sparkle. With her good brother and useful Sparkle, she continues to shop. They shopped and shopped and shopped until the brother begged her to stop. It seems like it was a nice day. At least for one of them, isn't it?
Let's talk some more about details. There are three main stakeholders in our system. First, everyone who can see denoted by green, gray. Second, the assistants of people with visual impairment denoted by green. And finally, the people with visual impairment marked red. We will describe how each user group contributes to and take advantage of our service. Let's say we have a piece of clothing that has some complex patterns. Using the camera, Sparkle Band can transform the pattern information into a braille that people with visual impairment can feel with their fingertips. So, how does it actually work? We have a software demo for this. The braille on the surface of the band will move up and down to create a texture that resembles the pattern. The color of each cell represents the height of each braille. So the whiter the cell, the higher the corresponding braille piece. Now let's see how sight people and assistants are involved in our system. First, sighted people. When they shop for clothes online, they will be asked to do a very small task for the people with visual impairment. The system will ask them to describe the colors they see with a few words. This crowdsourced data will be stored at the central database, and it will be used by Sparkle App, Sparkle Band, and other services. This crowdsourced data can be useful for everyone, even the sighted people. For example, Sparkle can offer the advanced searching and rich color dictionary. With Sparkle's rich color vocabulary system made by people, we can now search with a curry like British milk tea and expect some clothes which match that description. Furthermore, now we have a color dictionary that also contains descriptors of emotions and feelings attached to colors. Designers can easily reference and pick colors accordingly. As you saw in the video, The assistants can use the Sparkle app to get recommendations and describe colors easier. Do you still remember these colors? We got some help from the crowd through surveys, and this is what we got. Using the system, assistant can say about the color on the right, this is a light blue color, which reminds me cloudy day and makes me relaxed. So people who acquired visual impairment can imagine colors easily with the descriptions given, and people born with visual impairment can share the feelings that the sighted people feel from the color. And we will talk some more about the future applications of Sparkle. First, independence is important to all of us, but some of us don't fully enjoy it. We want to help people with visual impairment to shop freely on their own with Sparkle. Sparkle can drive them where the shopping mall they are looking for, and let them choose clothes and describe colors and patterns to them. And second, clothes are not the only ones that are hard to explain. Furniture, accessories, drawings, there are tons of things that are hard to describe. Sparkle makes describe easier. Thank you. Any questions?
Thank you, Korea. Who would like to start?
Yeah. Great job, guys. I really like this concept. I think you guys have done an amazing job, actually. You've got a ton of detail in here. There's a software service that you've designed, a platform for crowdsourced information and subjective, qualitative descriptions of color. There's a hardware device in here that's obviously got its own gamut of scenarios that you've only lightly touched on here. Not only that, you've the graphic communication work, the design of your presentation is really beautiful, the character design and all of those things. I think there's just tons to commend you on, and it even looks like there was some software image processing work done just to do some live video presentation. And let me just say that quite a lot of that happened between Monday and today. So, even more impressive for how far it's come. So well done.
Thank you.
So I think that was really interesting. I really like many aspects of this. I thought the Braille, the sort of representation of pattern via a sort of a tactile pattern thing was really interesting. I don't know, it'd be great to see some kind of progression on that and testing, and can people really feel it, and what does it mean to have polka dots versus, anyway, there's an awful lot of kind of understanding patterns, but it's really interesting. And I like the way that you thought about color in a and different ways of explaining that as well. I mean, I think it would have been great to see. I was not completely convinced by the way that the wrist thing worked with the app and the description of the color versus the pattern. I think that felt a little bit kind of disconnected. Apart from that, but it was really nice, and you did a great job explaining it.
I think this is really, really neat. I mean, it took me it took me a little while to get because the pattern that was taken off the rack had texture to it. It threw me off. You probably already heard this feedback. So I won't belabor the point. But once I got it, I started to kind of appreciate the kind of expansiveness of what you guys are going for here. This is a lot of vision and I always worry in those situations that maybe it's a lot in platform, but if you can produce that entire experience, I see the vision. I think it's really, really exciting. So what I was most excited about was the end result. I thought that the crowdsourced actual description was really kind of very helpful, very meaningful kind of in that response. And so just getting that part right in terms of how people give you the right words and how you discern that these are the right ones for this thing and for each of those cases, each color, each garment. I mean, that's a very expansive problem, even if you don't have hardware or anything else contributing to that. So, you know, I really, really like that part. And I see that as a piece of it that in and of itself has a lot of value. I don't know if that helps you at all, but I do enjoy the project. I like the branding, I like the look. So congrats, a lot of great work.
Thank you.
We have time for one question. Cindy? So the question was if you guys did any thinking about shopping online, because when you shop online, you have to rely a lot on the metadata that the website provides.
So we actually met and communicated with people with visual impairments, and we asked about the online shopping. And the answer was like depressed. We were depressed to hear that they do not enjoy online shopping as much as we do. They said that they use online shopping only with offline shopping. They go to the offline mall and they wear it and they try it out and they go back to their homes and they order it online because it's cheaper. And we did not quite think about how to make the online shopping better. Yes, that's all. Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you,
everybody. Hold on, let me just introduce you real quick. So next up, we have Fuzzy Bird, a buddy for autistic kids that supports them in good and bad times. This is Delft University of Technology from the Netherlands, and I will switch you over to their presentation. Take it away.
Thank you. So we're TU Delft, and my name is Max.
And I am Sophie, and we would like to present to you the Fuzzy Bird, which is a buddy for autistic children in good times and in bad times. This is a photo made during the exhibition where we presented the Fuzzy Bird at TU Delft. Our other teammates are Joseph and Astrid, and in the middle you can see Thomas, who unfortunately couldn't make it. We are in our first year of our master program called Design for Interaction in Delft, and we learn to design for real people. But again, for this project, that turned out to be quite a challenge. In America, 1 in 68 children is diagnosed with autism, which is a wide spectrum of disorders with a shared set of symptoms. Thomas, the 8-year-old boy, he's one of them. He's diagnosed with highly functional autism. He really likes repetitive behavior, structure, and order. And he really likes to feel and squeeze and touch different kinds of textures and materials. But in daily life, he sometimes has a hard time with social interaction. And Thomas has a fear for uncertainty. During this project, in the context of inclusive design, we tried to design for the 1%, but see how all the new insights we gained could also benefit for us all. So like for Emma, who is a very shy girl who doesn't dare to talk to other people. Or Noah, who is just very nervous for his first day at school. But let's pretend I'm Thomas, and I feel very tense, so I'll go to my Fuzzy Bird, and I'll start interacting with it. I will start squeezing and touching. And when I squeeze the left green wing, you will see the fuzzy bird tilt his head to the left and green lights will start to glow. It's a very direct and understandable reaction for Thomas, which is very nice because otherwise it would confuse me, and now it reassures me. When I start hugging the bird will start vibrating, and this cuddling movement will comfort me. And by petting the head, the bird will make a happy sound. It will make him very lively and friendly. I will trust the bird, and I will even find myself mirroring the bird. And after interacting with the bird, Thomas feels comfortable again.
So now if you've met the fuzzy bird and if you've met Thomas, I will go a little bit more into detail about the process and tell you about the insights. So our process is quite a roller coaster. It has some good times, but also some bad times. So we started off at a project with Aggie. Aggie? Yeah. Aggie had some flaws in the way it interacted with the user. Its movement was quite unpredictable, and that caused a lot of stress amongst the user. So that led to the insight that we should not only focus on what the product should do, but also what it shouldn't do. So developing our concept, we decided to lay the egg back in its nest and to see what will happen. So we waited for some time, and suddenly Fuzzy Bird was born. So also with this, I can give you an answer to the age-old question, what came first, the chicken or the egg? So with this concept, we went to see Helma van Rijn. She is a Dutch award-winning designer who is designing learning toys for kids that are diagnosed with autism. She gave us a pretty straightforward advice. You're not designing for the kids you were used to be. You're designing for the 1%, and you should really know your target group. Because autism has such a broad spectrum, some things work at certain people, but don't work at other people. So you have to simplify your concept to see what works and what doesn't. So that led to a little trouble. When you're designing and you're doing research, it's sometimes hard to synchronize the way of conceptual thinking with the way of programming and embodying your design. It's always important to test out your interactions to see if they are working. So sometimes you have to simulate or mimic the technical part in order to see if it's working. That led to our led to our working prototype, which we tested at a primary school in Delft. It had some kids with special needs, including Sam, who is highly functional autism. So we would like to share this impression with you that we made. And I really would like to point out the change over time of the facial expression of Sam. And see how he interacts with the fuzzy bird. So Sam is normally quite close and shy, trying not to have eye contact. But he starts to explore what he can do with fuzzy bird. He starts hugging, that comforts him. And he dares to speak up. Yeah. We really think that user testing is one of the most rewarding things in research and design because you can really test out your concept and see how it works. So I would also like to quote one of the teachers who told us that when Bob was going back to class after playing with Fuzzy Bird, he started interacting with other kids, telling about his experience with the fuzzy bird. So we do not only think that the fuzzy bird can have an effect on the short term, but also maybe on the long term. So here we are now with the fuzzy bird here in Redmond. But we also want to take a look into the future to see what the fuzzy bird can do. So I would like to quote one of the psychologists who stopped by at our expo in Delft. And she told us that the fuzzy bird reminded her of a transitional object. That's an object used by a therapist to gain the child's trust and to make him open up and tell about difficult events. So with these insights of inclusive design and designing for the 1%, we can try to find insights that can help us in designing for the rest and to create a benefit just not only for Thomas, but also for Emma and also for Noah. So I would really want you to come to our showcase and experience the fuzzy bird yourself. Thanks.
Thank you. That's a great picture. That also happened between Monday and Wednesday. So who would like to start?
Okay, well, you guys know you're doing well with this. I don't need to tell you. I need a fuzzy bird. Sometimes work gets kind of stressful. And so, it seems like a rather complicated issue, right? So you really, you know, your user testing and what you guys, I don't know, how many people have you actually tested?
We've tested with 8 different kids, boys and girls, varying from the age of 5 to 10.
Yeah, very interesting. It's all kind of in the results, right, for what you're going for here. And so a lot more testing, a lot more iterating, would be great. I mean, I think this concept, is really, really strong. I could probably keep going, right? I mean, there's probably quite a bit of innovation, quite a bit of additional features that you could keep adding, a lot more that you can do with it. So that's very exciting. And what a great, look, this is a platform. Look at this platform. What an awesome platform. Lovely. I'll give it to you for some critique.
Sure. great job, guys. I think this is probably, the most complete concept in out of all of the kind of work we're seeing. It's I love the journey that you got getting here, the fact that your prototype is fully functioning and you pulled off the presentation and demonstration of it really perfectly. That's very commendable. And that you subjected this to user evaluation and really learned through prototyping, that's all like just total magic for me in terms of just getting out of the theory, building it, and really learning from the hard knocks and the experiences of seeing it in the hands of your target audience. So totally commendable. Love the work. Great job.
Very thoughtful, great storytelling. You did a beautiful job of putting the story together and telling it and talking about the bits that were a bit, didn't work. It's like eggy, just wasn't there. And wove it into a story that was very neat and very nice. I think the only thing that I would have liked to have seen, just because you've done such a good job, something else, was thinking about other forms for this. I know you went from eggy to bird, but I kept kind of feeling a little kind of unsure about the form and the bird and the audience you were going for. Even, once you get to school, would you take that to school with you? And so kind of thinking about the world of stuffed animals and what was going to work for people and it being a platform, basically. So, that was just kind of next steps, really. Like, what else could you do? A really nice project.
Thank you.
We have time for questions from the audience.
Hi, really interesting project. I'm very curious if you were able to identify which aspects of Fuzzy Bird the children were responding to. Was it the form of the interaction? Was it the physical shape and the presence of a face or no face? Or did you have a way of testing that to find out?
I think they were reacting on both. We did not test how they reacted if it was not a recognizable animal, bird, so without a face. So that might be very interesting if that's actually necessary. But yeah, the direct feedback that the bird gave and I think definitely the features of this softness and somewhere cuteness. I'm not sure if you need the face for it, but the movement and that reaction both.
Yeah, and also the interaction with the bird is sort of human-like in a small way. So you're touching it, you're trying different stuff, you're cuddly. That can help in things that have to do with autism.
Okay, thank you so much, Delft. Next up, we have NYU Shanghai with, you can cheer for your school if you want, with Adaptool, helping amputees use tools directly without a prosthetic hand as an intermediary step.
Are you guys set up?
Hello, we're the NYU Shanghai team, and this is our product, Adaptool. I'm Kadala Burrows from Washington, D.C. in the United States.
My name is Selena, and I'm from Tuimazi, Russia.
My name is Fred Wu. I'm from Shanghai, China.
My name is Watcher. I'm from Beijing, China.
So this is our project, Adaptool, and Adaptool helps amputees to use tools directly without using a prosthetic hand as an intermediate step. So our school is located in China, and in China, the total population of amputees is even bigger than the total population of Netherlands. And the biggest, yes, Netherlands, hi. And the biggest problem those amputees are facing is 73% unemployment rate. Because most of the jobs and careers rely heavily on holding the tools. So we had the chance to interview an amputee who lost both of his arms in the firework accident. His name is Mr. Ku, and he works in China Disabled Persons Federation. So Mr. Ku confirmed that such unemployment problem does exist. And he also showed us how he comes up with creative ways on using the tools in his daily life. So in the next two videos, you would see him combing his hair and also drawing. So the way he does it now, he has this wristband and he stacks the hairbrush inside. However, this process takes time and connection is also really loose, so sometimes the hairbrush even falls down. The way he draws now, he is using both of his arms and his drawings are beautiful. And as Mr. Ku notices that one really important thing that both of his tools, the pencil and the hairbrush, lack now is stability. Stability is really important. And as you may notice, Mr. Ku now, he is not using a prosthetic hand. When you lose your arm, the obvious solution would be to get a new one. However, in our research, we found out that this solution doesn't always work.
So Mr. Ku thinks that it's better not to use a hand at all than to have a bad version of it. Unfortunately, most of the prosthetic hands now, they are not really efficient, they are not really reliable, and they are also quite expensive. Because the conventional idea of designing a prosthetic arm hand is design something that will look like a human hand. But in our research, we found out that in our daily life, most of the time we use our hand for holding the tools and using them. So we thought, why just don't we skip the grip?
Right. So in our research, we found that there are some people already doing so. So this man actually attached the chainsaw directly to his arm with a ball joint. We love this idea, but we also want to be able to use multiple tools. So we looked at Amy Mullings, who has 12 pairs of prosthetic legs, and we want to use this this idea of interchangeable legs to design a new prosthetic arm. So here is Adaptool, combining direct attaching and interchangeability. And it works like this. You just wear it. And so how can this thing, yeah, right. So how can this thing help Mr. Ku? So in the interview, we saw Mr. Ku walking in his garden trying to operate a spade. And he uses two arms and it's super complicated, but Adaptool will make everything so easy. So with Adaptool, you just put a tool into this tool socket and you click a button and the tool is fastened. And this is how it works. We designed this mechanism. So with Adaptool, like work like this, just one arm is enough for effective operation.
With more complex tools and more complex jobs, you need to be able to do more than just hold the object that you're using. In this video, we saw Mr. Ku operating a water hose. And while most people are able to just clench their fists in order to operate it, for Mr. Ku, it became quite a complex affair where he had to use both of his arms. Where he had to use both of his arms. But you can imagine that if Mr. Ku was trying to use something a little more dangerous, such as a screwdriver or a drill, you wouldn't really want to do such a thing because it could be quite dangerous. So with the use of Adaptool, where we plan on using multiple sensors, specifically myoelectric sensors, we're able to give amputees more control than they've ever had before. Myoelectric sensors read the electrical signals that your muscles give off when you contract them. And through Adaptool, we plan on allowing them to map out specific contractions to the actions that the tool is taking. In this video, we see someone who has used a pretty basic prototype of myoelectric controller to operate and turn on and turn off a drill. And if we apply this idea to Mr. Ku and his garden hose, then you can imagine instead of having to use two arms to operate, he would instead be able to simply clench his fist and aim the water at wherever he needs to water.
Okay, just in case that an amputee wants to implement even more complicated tools, he may need configuration. So we decided to add a touchscreen onto Adaptool, but we're not very sure if it is practical for an amputee to use touchscreen until we see this video.
我现在你说我什么不会，写写字，那玩玩手机，那一弄，那就是这样子，无非多弄一下吧，那这样，你说什么点不出，要写字。Okay,
so here we can see Mr. Ku is using his cell phone which has a touchscreen. It tells me that an amputee it's possible for an amputee to use touchscreen. So on the touchscreen of Adaptool, on touchscreen, you can adjust the settings of a specific tool. For example, in the case of water hose, you can adjust the water pressure by just moving the button on the touchscreen. And the last thing I want to mention about the Adaptool is the sleeve. So the sleeve is the part where the amputee puts his arm to Adaptool. it's very close to a normal prosthetic sleeve, but we want to make it more comfortable. So we use a special material called a memory foam, which can adjust its form to the arm. So something right here between the arm and the adaptor. So the amputee won't feel any pressure, even he wears adaptor for a long time. And we also have supportive bands around the shoulders, so which to make sure that the adaptor won't fall out, even if the tool is heavy.
But with all this talk of the technical, we don't want to lose sight of the most important part of our project, the user. So we asked Mr. Ku what he thought about Adaptool.
这个如果这样的东西你会考虑去用吗？当然会考虑，有嘛要看方便，对吧？没有的情况下，我只能用这个。你像你如果有个东西，这是卡住的啊，这样。我到中国要被缝一下，对，这个东西你比如说有个你设计的这么个东西，比如说啊，这上面有很多的功能，比如说这里一按一下，这个东西可以怕弹出来，然后你要放药的东西放进去，再怕它一个盘子把它卡住，那更稳当了。还有，哎，你能够给我。
Thank you for your time.
Are you Shanghai? Who would like to go first? I see a hand. Not at all.
So that was a really fascinating, really great project. And I think actually we all really need a round of applause for Mr. Ku, because what a brilliant kind of research participant. He was so good. You know, I think that was one of the like huge strengths of your project, was that you had this really interesting person and you went into such detail that you really saw and understood what he was trying to do. And so, you know, that you came out with this kind of output of basically your arm becoming, you know, sort of more like a drill than a drill bit, and that whole kind of idea of kind of, you know, taking the hand out was really a really great kind of step forward. I really like that. Sort of almost like kind of kept the end reminding me of those multicolor pens you get, you know, the green bit pokes out and then the changing the colors. I thought that was really, really lovely. And the, you know, also the technical thought through of things like using my electricity and how would I control it and what are you trying to do? So I thought that was really impressive and really interesting and kind of trying to solve a very fascinating problem, like for one very specific person, but you could see great, you know, the equivalent of Holland was going to be, the Netherlands was going to be doing it. So that's great. Well done.
All right, so you guys have seen Inspector Gadget. it's amazing. I mean, this is the kind of thing that you see and you sort of go, this doesn't exist already. I can't believe it doesn't exist already. So for you guys to come up with it is, you know, both all the criteria you want to look for, right? It's it just feels right. And so it seems like a thing in the world that will make a lot of lives better. So congrats. That's really, really, that's the whole goal, right? Great work.
Yeah, I echo both those sentiments. I think Mr. Ku is just the most amazing find. And I think I love how when you encountered him, I don't know the full genesis of the story, but like I think you went from designing a tool for a single amputee to one that would work for a double amputee, which is, you know, upping the challenge even more for yourself. And again, this is, why doesn't this exist? Is sort of like this puzzling question. It's definitely something that needs to exist. It sort of feels, you know, empowering in so many different and diverse scenarios for so many people. So great job, great concept, really simple concept, super challenging execution. Would love to have seen more prototyping, you know, and something to evaluate for Mr. Ku and get some iteration going in that design. But the concept itself, super strong. So, and great, great user research. So, well done.
Any questions from the audience?
Just say, you're
could have sold everybody in the audience one of those. It was unbelievable. I was reaching for my wallet. It was so good.
I totally agree. No questions? Okay, thank you so much, guys. This is great. Next up, we have the Arts Center College of Design from the U.S. They're going to present Radical Sensing, Super Smelly Neuroprosthetic. Hold on to your seats now.
Hi, I'm Selwa Sweden. Is the mic on?
Yeah. My name is Jay Hong.
And we're from Art Center College of Design's Graduate Media Design Practices program. So instead of seeing disability as something to fix, our professor's brief was to invert disability and design for a superpower. Radical sensing is rooted in the sense of smell, and radical sensing imagines a future in which we've chosen to replace our noses with a super smelling neuroprosthetic or a post nose. It filters it shares and it remembers scent.
The super smelling neuroprosthetic amplifies, isolates, and records scent through hand gestures and customization to your post nose.
For centuries, scholars have placed smell at the bottom of a hierarchy of senses. Condillac, Darwin, and Kant, they've all described the sense of smell as the least useful of the senses.
But we chose scent.
Yeah, we chose scent as a way to really design for the emotive, non-rational, intuitive aspects of brain computing. And really, thanks to brain scanning imaging technology, the hegemonic divide between what we know and what we don't know and the rational collapse thanks to this. So here we see a scan, going back a little forward.
Oh.
Here we are. Here we see a scan of the olfactory pathways in the brain. And really, the sense of smell is actually the most complex of the senses because of how it functions and how it's mapped through the brain. So we spoke to experts in computational neurology, anaplastology, brain-computer interface hardware development, and also we collaborated with an independent perfumer.
These are our three noses. We imagine fitting them to a person's face once their noses are removed. So it is a radical idea. So why not a radical prosthetic?
So for example, this one is inspired by techno. This is our techno nose. And here we have our sleeping nose to protect you while you sleep. And this one challenges the architecture of the nose.
So what does it mean for the replacement of the body part to become aspirational?
So currently, there is no neuroprosthetics for smell. So how do you design for something that doesn't exist? This led us to the idea of working with performers. And by performers, we mean those with specialized training in movement and dance.
Radical sensing is in dialogue to this performer and body researchers. Second to the left is Luxi McCrae, who works with boundaries of human body and dynamism of technology.
So there are clear advantages to working with performers.
Their spatial vocabulary allows for rich messaging and interpretation in a very collaborative manner. It is a symbolic and a metaphoric process. It turns formal movement into narrative, which then we work off.
So we created this methodology, which we started calling performative prototyping. And instead of being a narrowing process, it is very divergent and generative. And this allowed us to really work with concepts that don't exist.
Over time, we've made working prototypes, and these were used for our performative prototyping iterations.
And these iterations led to these three areas. So GCMS is a technology used by the perfume industry and scientists to analyze and measure scent. Enos technology takes us to a portable scale. So if you imagine that this could merge with the neuroprosthetics of the nose, this would be a huge change in the way we could record and store scent. This is how memory works. And based on this technology, we here are showing two performers recording and sharing scent.
To begin, we conducted three scent tests with a diverse group of performers. We were interested in the relationship between language to smell. And so we asked the performers to verbalize their reactions.
So that led us to think, would a smell memory device facilitate a richer discourse around smell? And would that lead to a smell literacy?
To move on to augmented function, we tested stereo smell. We asked the performers to do improvisation through long extended straws, which then made us think about control.
So initially our questions were, what does it mean to augment smell to be more precise or focused or enhanced? But later our questions became about, what does it mean to relinquish control of smell, both willingly or unwillingly?
This led us to sharing. This test is about the sharing dynamic between leader and follower.
And we took this idea of sharing and intimacy to the extreme by giving the performers a very restrictive prototype, which they described as painful.
We repeated the test with performers who knew each other very well. And they were able to be less challenging for them, and they were able to move more quickly.
So since they were moving so much more confidently, it led us to consider, how does familiarity affect ability?
And during our debrief, they mentioned about the synchronization of breath, for them to move easily.
Yeah, so and then through this, it allowed us to consider, could the breath be used as a cue in sharing of smell?
So to recap, we used the methodology of performative prototyping to reach to these three areas.
With memory, how does a smell memory device impact the language around discourse and smell literacy? With control, what does it mean to design for an ability to control or relinquish control of smell? And finally, with sharing, what does sensorial consensus mean? Can we use the breath to facilitate consensus?
We took a radical approach to look into the future, to explore designing possibility around superpower and ability.
In the process, we came up with a methodology that we're calling performative prototyping, which led us in a different direction than if we had taken a more conventional approach. Radical sensing looks at neuroscience, physical computing, and performance research to really explore the potentials of designing around a radical augmentation of smell and also a radical prosthetic. Radical sensing imagines a future in which we've chosen to replace our noses with a super-smelling neuroprosthetic or a post-nose.
Thank you.
Thank you, Art Center. Who would like to go first?
I'm yeah, where do you start? It's a wonderful project, and I commend you on sort of taking the approach of looking at augmentation of powers, superpowers, and sort of exploring this from a very different sort of starting point. the performative prototyping, I think, is absolute genius. And I think the video communication storytelling that you do in this presentation is like amazing, right? I mean, you're just doing, there's all sorts of storytelling going on about what you've explored and how you explored it. And I'm left very much with the impression that, you know, perhaps not as radically as you suggest in this incredibly bizarre moment where, you know, we see this void in the nose cavity. But just that the idea that there could be devices that, you know, enhance or give us superpowers of smell or recall or, as you said, record and share. There's something definitely super exciting there, and I'm compelled to imagine a future in where, you know, we have the sense of, a heightened sense of smell and be able to share those incredible moments. But anyway, just very bold, very creative. Great job.
Yeah, I mean, certainly the subject matter is fascinating, right? Especially when you're exploring memory as it pertains to smell. This is something I've always been very curious about. I find my sense of smell fluctuates different times in my life. You know, it's more vibrant, other times it's less, different months. The result here could be really, really fascinating, and this seems like one of those projects that really starts to contribute to a base of knowledge that we're going to need to get there. I really just like the presentation, I think, and the project and the work, and to sort of be you for a second, because you know, there's a lot of art in this, there's a lot of exploration in this, there's a lot of creativity in it, and it's a lot of out-of-the-box thinking, and so that's very, very exciting. So, you know, what resulted in its practical applications here, I don't know, but the step, I think, is really exciting to see. Great presentation. Thank you.
Yep, echo those. I love the way that you kind of went out, way out, but kind of that forced you to really think about some of the things and actually, you know, what would that be like? And I think that's something that, you know, for some of the other projects, I think that, you know, kind of would have been really helpful. Like, what would it be like to wear this? What would it be like to use it, to be that, to have that as part of my daily life? You know, if I capture a smell and I give it to somebody else, what's that going to be like? I mean, those are really interesting questions to think about. And the way that you did it was incredibly evocative, and I think that was great. You know, so very kind of a different way of doing that, and I, you know, so I really enjoyed that. And, you know, and taking just a complete departure of what did it mean to sort of reverse that feel of a, you know, contextual disability. Well, could you, you know, being differently abled, as it was called for a long time, you know, actually, yeah, be differently abled. Have it like super nose is kind of a really different way of thinking about it. So I thought that was a great project. Really liked it.
Thank you very much.
Any questions from the audience? Stella?
So thank you very much for your presentation. And so here I own up. I am someone with this invisible disability of having mostly no sense of smell. And what I love about your project is that it actually shows things that I do. For example, when I go for a walk together with my husband, he tells me, now it smells of grass. And I go, oh, is it really? And then I'm going, okay, maybe I can smell just a little bit of it. So I try to go... So actually what this is one of the behaviors that you showed in your movies. And so what I think is really nice about it is that it's beyond the product, because actually it enables me to recognize that this is something that we're doing and I can talk about it. So it's actually a direct mediator of experiences without a product in the sense that I'm using a product, but actually it enables people to share experiences. So I love that.
Thank you so much for sharing your experience. I'd love to talk to you more.
Any more questions? Clay Shirky?
The performative prototyping idea seems to even transcend your project, just as a general technique. As you guys were doing that, did you think, oh, I know what else this would be useful for? Like, when would you use that again, or for what other kinds of projects?
Thank you, and that's a really good question. I think we've been meditating on it or trying to understand, but I guess it started when we took a dance choreographic practice I have and applied it to some design research, and I found it to be a very satisfying experience. But I think, at least from my perspective at this moment, I see it as really applying to brief creation and maybe insight finding when the space is very broad. I think kind of how we talked about it, when you're really open and you need to be led down a different path. But besides that, it's just really fun. Yeah. Thank you.
Questions?
Unless somebody else has a question. Okay, so back to Clay's point. I mean, there are some earlier work around sort of informants and some early papers around that, but I think that's always been using the kind of performance to tell the idea much more than, that sort of prototyping and using those performance and dances to kind of, because they're, as you say, so good with thinking their bodies. So I thought that, yeah. Very much so, that was a great idea. Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
Any other questions or comments? Okay, thank you so much, Art Center.
Thank you. The whole table.
Next up, we have our home team, University of Washington, with Loom, a storytelling experience for your tight-knit community.
So we are from the University of Washington's Division of Design. I am Jennifer. This is Charlotte, Catherine, Jaewon, and Kendall, and we're really excited to share our project with you today. Loom is a tool for friends and family to collectively weave stories. A bit about how we got here. We are really interested in the social experiences of older adults, an area that is far less explored or designed for than, for example, the medical aspects of aging. To better understand this space, we reached out to the Wallingford Community Senior Center and were able to spend some time there. We served lunch and visited a few times and were able to spend time with people at the center to better understand the social context of older adults. And we did this through observation and simply sitting down and having conversations with them. One thing we noticed was the popularity of tabletop games like dominoes or bridge, and the director of the center shared a really valuable insight with us that activities that people think of as more sedentary or passive actually serve a very important purpose to keep people connected and for cognitive simulation. One particularly moving example of this at the Senior Center is the knitting circle that has been around for 40 years, getting people to just sit down, engage in conversation. And we ran with this metaphor of the knitting circle as we designed a physical prompt for storytelling. So Loom is a tool to just get people sitting and talking and to weave conversations and memories.
So when people talk about a family photo, they usually start with one story and then branch off into many different stories related to that one story. Loom actually captures the connections between these memories in addition to the memories themselves. And once we had this idea, we wanted to try and explore it and expand it with Yoko and Ichi, a great couple we met at the Senior Center. And so we quickly developed our prototype and then asked them to just share their family stories with us, and our video is a documentation of the experience they had.
Next month, it'll be 58 years. He's 92 and I'm 85.
He loves to look at old pictures. Nice memories will come back, and so he enjoys that. Every time he gets a chance, he would love to tell the stories. Lots of stories, countless.
My father went up to Mount Rainier, you know, and he made it up. When you look at the picture, well, it looks like he's the tallest one.
And I think it's good for our family, our children and grandchildren, to know what kind of life he had and what kind of hardship he overcame, and he never gave up.
My father went up to Mount Rainier, you know, and he made it up.
He had lots of friends. Although most people passed away, but looking at all the pictures, you know, and he likes to think about the people he met all through his life.
Oh, well, that must be the flag that my father put up there.
So I think that each story comes alive, you know, it's true to them, yeah.
Well, it was nice talking to you. I'm glad I know all about you now. I know that you talk.
Bye. Bye.
So by spending time with Ichi, we saw how excited he was to use Loom to share stories and recount his family history, but we also learned a little bit about how to further develop our concept. So in the video, we used prototypes made out of old iPhones and realized that the size was actually a little bit small, which leads us to imagine that the Loom system could actually be applied across a whole variety of larger devices. This also means that even old devices could be upcycled by simply adding a wooden frame to give it more warmth and a friendlier feeling. We also realized that we take the complexity of touch interactions for granted, so for Ichi, distinguishing between tap and tap and hold wasn't really possible. So we decided to minimize the touch interface and instead focus more on voice direction to create a more accessible multi-input experience. So the way the system works, when Ichi tells his stories, Loom records them and attaches them to a specific photo. And this content lives in the cloud, and photos can come from existing photo sharing services, such as Facebook or Instagram, that Loom could build on top of, or people could choose to upload individual photos. And because this content is in the cloud, Ichi can not only access his photos when he's at home, but also when he's in the senior center or when he's visiting family and friends. And having multiple devices allows for the same type of collaborative activity that prompts storytelling, that the knitting circle does that we've discovered in the senior center. And because you can use any number of devices, the system is really flexible in allowing you to tell a great variety of stories.
So as you saw in our video, we toyed with this idea of arrangements. But what we discovered was that the placement of the devices isn't really what matters. What's more important is that Loom captures the individual threads that connect these stories together. For example, in this photo, when Yoko and Ichi were telling the story together, their story is linked to the gestures that they make on the photograph, visualizing the experience of that conversation, like who told which part of the story and what area of the photograph they pointed to. This narrative context adds a deeper layer of meaning to the photos, and these can be played back and shared with family and friends so that they can get details that are not immediately apparent in that photograph. Shared across generations, these memories come alive. And we think that the potential of Loom offers the ability to apply to other contexts. Such as schools, the workplace, or museums. Really any other number of social contexts where a physical object can prompt conversation. One of the most touching experiences that we had throughout this process is that moment captured in the video where Mary says, "You talk, I know that you talk now." And it's because she had never really heard him speak. This is because HE has some loss of hearing, and that sometimes prevents him from being able to engage in conversation. But we really saw him sort of come alive and open up and tell these amazing stories with those family photos in front of him, to the point where we basically couldn't get him to stop talking. And this really speaks to the potential transformative value of Loom. Like an actual loom, this is a tool that you weave with. And the outcome of this is a continuously growing fabric composed of the narrative threads from the most important people in your life. Thank you.
Thank you, University of Washington. Who would like to go first?
So where are you guys now in the product development phase? I mean, is this something that's out and people can download it as an app, or where is it?
Still at the conceptual level.
Yeah. All right, cool.
To explore this idea.
Yeah, that's really great. I really find this to be very meaningful, and I really like it. I always debate, you know, there's what you're introducing is essentially a microphone with a photo, right? So the technology is actually very, very simple, but what you're providing is the context for this to occur, and that's an area that can work or sometimes doesn't work. It really depends on the thing. Here, I think it really can work. I think there's a lot of potential to the idea because, you know, while a network like, I don't know, Facebook can add a functionality to record, you know, sound over a photo, and that would be a feature for Facebook, the contextual nature of having an app that gives you kind of that closeness to your family is actually the only place where you really kind of want that kind of depth for most photos, I think, or where you'd really consume that experience. So that's really exciting. I really like the brand. I think you guys have really nailed the word. It's just so good for it. I just really like it. And I think the simplicity really, really helps, especially with the demographic that you're working with there. So, you know, I encourage you to look at, I haven't done this research, but any networks that pertain to family that already exist, you know, could be threatening to you, or you might want to become that network quite directly as a thought. But I think the brand would work for both, right? So it's very promising, and, you know, happy to talk to you guys another time if it helped.
Yeah, very nicely presented and put together and project. Very, very engaging video. I did have to, you know, I was like, it would be embarrassing if I cry. that was lovely. I mean, you did the video was really well done, and, you know, a little bit sushy, but that was okay. And, you know, and the fact that you had, you thought about the inclusiveness of your video and included subtitles, which was kind of a good touch. I kept thinking about almost like the literal out of box here. You know, and thinking you kind of fudge this a little bit about, well, the photos can come from anywhere, but I think really thinking about how you move from a sort of online repository of photos to how many of these things do you actually have, and how does that picture get on it, and what that's like. I feel like that would be incredibly central to that experience of setting it up. I think that would feel really important, and I think it's worth spending time on that, much like you had about, okay, well, I can't do all that swiping and stuff, you know, you'd have a very simple interaction. So how do you make that whole setup experience simple, I think would be vital. But really nice project.
Yeah, I commend you guys on the video storytelling, and there's this little detail which probably everybody noticed, but I, you know, on viewing it a second time, noticed again, which is the fact that the wife of the central participant is actually narrating the story, which, you sort of forget the storytelling elegance of that as a, you know, it's not you guys telling the story. It's actually, you know, somebody who's been affected by the concept and seen the transformative effect it had on their partner. So that video is really quite masterful. Congratulations on that. I feel like the concept, I feel very similar. Like there's a lot of just because it's such a simple idea of tying sort of the narrative, the storytelling to the picture and having that recording and the sharing and the sort of longevity of that idea, those ideas and stories for a family. It's such a simple thing that, but there are so many kind of horrible barriers for getting, you know, even those photographs digitized and where to put them and the setup experience. And again, I feel like it's you definitely skipped over a lot of that detail, and maybe it's all done. You know, I don't know the extent to which you've explored this, but it feels like many of those, many of the power of this idea would come to life in those moments, and the fact that it would be a very successful service that I'm sure would have actual, real commercial value if you could get those experiences nailed and really, really think about that kind of, you know, that long user experience. From first touch to several years later, a relative stumbling upon and hearing the story for the first time. So there's some great work here. I encourage you to keep going. It's really, really solid.
Any questions from the audience? Richard Banks.
This is great, really enjoyed it. I really like that idea particularly of giving old devices a second life, that kind of renewal. I think one question for you is actually about the future, as much about the system as it is currently, because what you're doing to some extent is building a system of legacy. So there's a question about what happens to all this content and what happens to all the artifacts when these people unfortunately have kind of passed away. And I wonder what impact that has on how you think about the service. Is there a commitment you can make to these kinds of services and systems that maybe last 30, 40, 50 years as these objects become an important central part for families to reminisce about people who are a part of their ancestry? Have you thought at all about that, kind of the long term of these kinds of systems?
We've thought some about that, mostly that that we saw this as an experience for these older people, but also really as an experience for ourselves too. Like if you think about your grandparents and the kinds of stories that they have that you haven't captured, and they're getting older and older. So really any generation below or, you know, after would benefit from that. And so,
yeah, I guess for us, it was kind of also thinking of a different way to archive things that people share with you, right? So every time we've shared this concept with people, or even kind of personal places we came from, is, oh, I have a grandparent with Alzheimer's, or, oh, I have a grandparent who, right, lived through World War II, and these are all experiences that start vanishing even before that person's maybe passed away, because those intricacies just aren't really there anymore. So, yes, yeah, I don't know if we understood your question quite correctly, but I guess, yeah, we imagine that, I guess, no matter where technology or systems that would hold this kind of content go, there would always be people who want that there, because you always will care about your own personal family. And I think even business people who want to just like make money, right? They always care about their family. And that, I guess, is an incentive.
Even them.
To continue supporting this type of content. Yeah, thinking about it practically, just on the real.
Thank you.
Hold on, Mike. There's a question here in the back. Kat Holmes.
Hey, beautiful project. Thanks for sharing. And I was interested to hear a little bit more about your experience as designers through the course of this project, because I do believe that one of the most important pieces of inclusive design is the inclusion of people in the process, that, you know, both we as designers and then also the people we work with in our designs change through the process of creating some kind of solution. So I'm interested to hear kind of what it was in your journey in, you know, spending that amount of time. It was clear that you had spent some real dedicated time understanding and getting to know the people you shared today. So love to hear more about that. How was that experience?
Yeah, absolutely. It was a really humbling experience to be able to kind of be welcomed into the center, and especially welcomed into Ichi and Yoko's home. Really, we had a really nice like time doing this. We started it like have a really meaningful relationship. We like started. We gave them flowers. And then some of us graduated, and they gave us graduation presents. And then we cried in the parking lot for, I kid you not, 15 minutes. So, but I guess on another note, it was also kind of a frustrating experience because of how meaningful these like short-term visits and things like that were. It was frustrating that we realized that we could only spend X amount of time dedicated to research and spending time with these people, and that we want to be able to develop like longer research cycles or like periods to this kind of work, especially with the idea of designing for accessibility.
I think the other thing that was sort of different about our process is that we have this idea that you have to go in with this preconceived idea, and then you go and test it and see what it's like. And we went there without any idea what we were going to see. We went there with a completely blank slate just to spend time there. And the knitting circle, those kinds of things that we observed turned into the idea itself. I don't know if I explained that very well, but yeah, that we didn't already go there with this concept in mind. I think we really grew from that experience.
So along a similar line, I'm fascinated, and I haven't asked you this question yet, but it's been in the back of my head. So you're probably 20-somethings who likely fall asleep and the last thing to hit the floor is your cell phone or your smartphone, right? Because like all of us, you're probably on it all the time. And weirdly, the import of photographs to us has seemingly lost some of its meaning. I mean, I think about an Onion article that said, girl finishes uploading 1 million pictures of 1 week trip to Paris, right? Like, we just constantly are flashing photographs to the point where it loses a great deal of meaning. So when you're embedded in your ethnographic research in this senior center and not crying in the parking lot, and you see the importance that these photographs have to these people as a, not only as a memory, but as a way of knitting together an idea of the life that they led. How did that change your relationship with the way that you're using photographs on your cell phones and the way you're taking Instagram photos of your food? I mean, did it change your perception of that slightly?
I think that maybe we haven't changed our perception, but thinking about the potential for digital photographs is interesting. Our professor kind of put it in this way, that we're able to kind of make digital photographs physical again and create artifacts out of them, even just with the photos and not with the Loom system.
I guess it kind of maybe has changed our perception, or maybe this is something we knew but kind of realized again, even though yes, we are taking a million pictures during our 1 week trip to Paris, right? There's always that couple that stand out. So for every 50 croissants, there's like one of me petting this dog that reminds me of my dog that passed away or something that kind of sticks in my mind. So I think for me personally, it was kind of even realizing we both went on a trip together recently to Asia, and even while being there, it was like, which of these photos am I going to care about later? Is it the cool lights in the elevator or seeing the reaction of my friends to those cool lights?
Thank you. Thank you so much, UW. Well, this is a wrap. This was really a group effort. It was months of liaisons and professors and students and volunteers working together. So it's great to see it coming all together, and we all left inspired and hopefully different designers. And we have a showcase tonight. So all the groups are going to be in the showcase together with the Imagine Cup students. And it's from 6 to 8 p.m. at Thunder and Trident here on Building 92. And we also have another showcase tomorrow. And Lily wants to say something.
All right, so thank you all for coming. Special thanks to a few people. Mike, who comes here all the time and helps us and has spent the last couple days giving feedback. Thank you. Carolyn, I don't know where she is. She's probably out there with Sarah, but say thanks to them on the way out. And special thanks to Melissa. Melissa. She's coordinating this. You're a liaison, and you did all the brand and everything. And so thank you so much. It was awesome.
Thank you, Lily. Thank you, Lily, for being the sponsor and for Curtis Wong to actually starting Design Expo. And for our thank you so much for our critics. You guys were amazing. Oh, and for Steve Kaneko for having the party on Friday. So I hope you guys can make it. We heard his house looks really nice. Thank you all, this is great.
Each year, Microsoft Research hosts hundreds of influential speakers from around the world, including leading scientists, renowned experts in technology, book authors, and leading academics, and makes videos of these lectures freely available.